Hi everyone, my name is Sarah Mari. I'm one of the librarians at Portland Public Library in Portland, Maine, and today I'm here to talk to you about sea otters. Sea otters are adorable ocean creatures, and today we're going to read two books about them. The first one will tell you a little bit about sea otters, in case you don't know what they are, and the second one is about a specific sea otter. We'll get it there. So our first book is called Sea Otters. Now, this is a nonfiction book, which means that everything in this book is true. So it was written by Beth Wagner Burst, but you can see right here that they had a zoological consultant, Charles R. Schroeder, which means that they had someone who went to school to learn about animals for a very long time, help them with this book to make sure that they got all the details right. And they had two scientific consultants as well, Sam Ridgway and Marianne Reedman. All of these people work with aquatic animals at different zoos and research facilities. You can also tell that this is a nonfiction book because it has a table of contents. Now, a table of contents tells you what things are in different sections of the book. And there's also some credits over here for all of the art and photography that's part of this wildlife education zoo book. Sea otters are truly irresistible. Look at how cute. They're cute and cuddly looking with friendly faces and playful personalities. It's hard to believe that these delightful creatures were once hunted to almost extinction. But at one time, sea otters were in great demand for their pelts to make fur coats. Fortunately, in recent years, sea otters have made a remarkable comeback. Although some populations are still threatened, their numbers are increasing throughout most of their range. There are 12 species of otter, but only one of them is a sea otter. The others are river otter. All the others are river otters. Otters belong to the weasel family, which includes weasels, skunks, minks, sables, ermines, wolverines, and badgers. The scientific name for sea otters is Enhydra lutris, which means, not surprisingly, otter in the water. This name fits sea otters well because they spend almost all their time in the ocean. They eat, sleep, mate, give birth, and feed their young at sea. They are the most aquatic of all otters. Sea otters are the largest members of the weasel family. They are also the smallest of all marine among the smallest of all marine mammals. Like whales and other marine mammals, like all mammals, they breathe air, feed milk to their young, are warm-blooded, and have hair on their bodies. Do you know what else is a mammal? People are mammals. Sea otters are found only in the North Pacific Ocean, where they live along rocky shorelines and sheltered coves. Approximately 168,000 otters live in the waters off Alaska and Russia, while about 2,400 California sea otters live along the central California coast. Groups of sea otters, called rafts, float among kelp beds where there's plenty of food. Playful by nature, sea otters are sometimes called the clowns of the kelp bed. But their playfulness and curiosity contributed to their near extinction earlier in the century. While the return of the sea otters is a success story, it's important to guard against future threats to their safety. A sea otter is well suited to life in the ocean. Its flexible, cylindrical body moves through the water with ease, but drags clumsily on the ground when it comes ashore. This is because its short legs, so powerful in the water, can't support the sea otter's long body on land. Males reach a body length of about 4 feet and have a foot-long tail. They can weigh as much as 90 pounds or more. Females are somewhat smaller. For its size, a sea otter's lungs are twice as large as those of other mammals. Large lungs give sea otters more oxygen for diving and even help them float better. When sea otters are in a hurry, they swim underwater on their stomachs. They pump their bodies up and down, pushing hard with their hind feet to move them forward. To get around on the surface, sea otters swim on their backs. Usually they kick their hind feet out to the side, but sometimes they just swish their tails back and forth without using their feet at all. A sea otter's forepaws are very sensitive. They have short claws that usually don't extend beyond the edge of the pod. the paw. They also have tough pads on their paws to help them grip slippery fish and pick up prickly sea urchins. Inside their paws, they have 5 individual fingers, much like your fingers. Sea otters are powerful and graceful swimmers, using large muscles in their hindquarters to help them move forward in the water. The strong muscles in their forearms help them open shellfish and pry abalone and mussels off the rocks. Sea otters can hear quite well, and they hold their small ears upright to the surface to listen for danger. But when diving, they point their ears downward to keep out the seawater. When swimming in murky or dark water with low visibility, sea otters use their sensitive whiskers to find their way around. Their whiskers also help sea otters feel vibrations in the water. The smaller and sleeker river otters have longer legs than sea otters. That makes them agile on land as they are in water. There are many species of river otters that scamper over rocks and riverbanks in North, Central, and South America, Europe, Africa, and Asia. Although one species frequents the coastal islands of Chile and Peru, none but the sea otter is adapted for a life spent at sea. Sea otters have strong jaws and large round teeth to help them crush the shells of crabs, snails, and sea urchins. Their big lower teeth, called incisors, jut forward and are used to scoop the meat out of the shells. See for yourself how a sea otter's pad work. Pull a sock over your hand and now write with a pencil. See how well you can control the pencil, even though your thumb and fingers are covered? In the same way, a sea otter can manipulate objects even though its paws are covered with mitten-like skin. If you look closely at a sea otter's back feet, you will see that the outside toe is the longest and the inside is the smallest. Just the opposite of your toes. For otters, this works. Your feet are designed for walking, but with a large outer toe, an otter can spread its webbed feet wider for swimming. Sea otters have extremely flexible spines. This allows them to bend their body backwards and forwards into a complete circle. A flexible spine also enables a sea otter to reach every inch of its body when cleaning its fur. As you will find out on the next page, clean fur is very important. A sea otter's coat must be groomed and cleaned constantly. Clean fur is a matter of life and death for a sea otter. This is the only marine mammal without a layer of fat or blubber to keep it warm in the cold ocean. Instead, the sea otter's thick fur must keep it warm. Sea otters have the thickest fur of any animal in the world. In fact, some otters have as many as 1 billion hairs on their body. But it's not the fur alone that keeps the otters warm. A sodden and soggy coat would be cold. Instead, a protective pocket of air at the base of the fur insulates sea otters from the ocean's chill. Because their fur is so dense, sea otters must spend a great deal of time each day grooming themselves. If they don't groom, the fur gets matted and cannot hold air bubbles. Then the water seeps through to their skin and the cold kills them. By keeping clean, sea otters stay healthy and warm. See for yourself how air bubbles keep sea otters afloat. Fill a sink with water, then push a dry sponge under the water. See the bubbles coming out of the sponge as it fills up with water? Now it barely floats. If a sea otter doesn't often fluff up its fur to trap bubbles, they don't float well either. Now squeeze out the wet sponge and set it on the water surface. See how it floats higher in the water? That's because you've replaced the water with air bubbles. That's just what a sea otter does when it grooms itself. It squeezes out the water to make room for bubbles. When a sea otter dives underwater, a constant stream of bubbles rises from its coat. Although these bubbles are essential for warmth, they can make it harder for an otter to dive deep. Otters prefer to find water and food in shallow water. A sea otter has 2 types of hair. There are the long, coarse strands called guard hairs, and there are the shorter, finer hairs called underfur. When otters groom themselves, they are actually fluffing up their underfur to trap tiny air bubbles between their hair. These bubbles make a shield that blocks the cold water. A sea otter uses its forepaws to clamp the water out of its fur. In addition to rubbing hard to get air to stick next to its skin, an otter might blow into its thick coat. This traps even more air under the surface. Although a sea otter looks soft and cuddly, it would probably snap at anyone trying to pet its fur. Sea otters don't usually enjoy having their coats touched because this could soil their fur and be harmful to their health. Using its sharp claws as a comb, the sea otter will scratch and brush its fur to untangle and clean it. A grooming sea otter will roll and twist and squirm to reach every inch of its fur. Its coat is so loose around its body that an otter can pull it around to clean areas that are hard to reach. Many dogs like this German Shepherd also have thick fur, but it's not nearly as thick as sea otter. Sea otters have at least 4 times as much fur on their body as German Shepherds. You can see this dog fur compared to this sea otter fur. It would be impossible to part it with a comb and see the skin. They don't shed hair like some other animals. Instead, they lose a few old hairs at a time and grow a few new ones all year long. Sea otters eat many different types of food, and a lot of it. Shellfish is their favorite food, especially clams, scallops, mussels, and abalone. But they like crabs, sea urchins, squid, snails, octopus, and fish. They prefer food that they can pick up easily or pry off rocks. In areas where sea otters have been living for a long time, studies show that individual otters have their own favorite food. They prefer foods that would explain why so many otters can live peacefully in the same type of area. To collect and eat their food, sea otters often use large stones as tools. Humans, a few other primates, and sea otters are the only mammals known to use tools. They use stones as hammers to break loose mussels from the rock, and they also bang shellfish against flat stones to crack open their hard shells. To find food, a sea otter might dive deeply, but otters usually prefer shallow water where the food is easier to reach. Their average dive is about 35 feet and lasts about a minute. When necessary, sea otters can stay submerged for several minutes. A sea otter feeds at the surface, floating on its back. It takes the flat stone it has carried in its pouch and places it on its chest. Then, holding the food between both paws, it pounds the shell on the stone until it cracks open. The otter in this photo is eating a sea urchin. While they're eating and after, sea otters roll in the water to wash off any bits of food that is on their shell to keep it from getting stuck in their fur. People who harvest shellfish blame sea otters for eating too many. It's true that otters eat a lot of shellfish, but there are fewer shellfish along the California coast, even in places where there's no sea otters. This suggests that it is people who are taking too many shellfish, not sea otters. Kelp grows very quickly under the water, but it also provides home for many types of sea creatures. Sea otters help kelp growing by eating the sea urchin, its greatest enemy. Kelp is important because it can turn into a powder called alginate, which is used as a thickener in milkshakes, ice cream, and toothpaste. It's also used in frozen dinners, juices, and salad dressings, as well as medicines and vitamins. Have you had your kelp today? These are 2 Alaskan sea otters. Few mothers are as loving and devoted to their young as sea otters. Sea otter pups need good mothers because they are totally helpless at birth. They can barely swim, they can't feed themselves, and they don't know how to clean their fur to stay warm. For the first month of its life, a sea otter pup rests quietly on its mother's chest as she cuddles, grooms, and feeds it. Until the pup is about 6 months old, the mother never leaves it except for to look for food. Sea otter mothers have only one pup at a time, probably because young pups need so much attention. Generally, sea otters are social animals. Although they feed by themselves, they often gather together in rafts to rest in their favorite kelp bed. Sea otters are the only otters that group together this way. So sea otters nap for short periods of time because they eat in the day and at night. Whether they're young or old, they sleep with their paws tucked up under their chin or held over their eyes. Sea otter pups are born on land and in the water. They only weigh 4 to 5 pounds at birth. Young pups, like the one nestling with its mother here, spend most of their time resting on their mother's chest to stay warm. You can also see one here. There's the mom and that's the baby. Sharks, killer whales, or orcas and bald eagles are the sea otter's natural enemies. To feed its young, an eagle may swoop down and snatch a young sea otter pup away from its mother when the mother is off looking for food. When escaping from danger, a sea otter mother tucks her pup under her forepaws. The pup is large. She sinks her teeth into its loose fur and pulls it under. Pups are not strong enough to dive by themselves until they are a little bit older. But sea otter pups love to play and fur, and they learn to groom from their mothers because that's one of the most important things. Sometimes, if a mother has to leave a pup alone, she wraps it in kelp to keep it from drifting away, or fluffs it up. Sleepy sea otters often huddle themselves in kelp so they don't float away and wake up in a different location. Dangers to sea otters began when people started hunting them for their fur in the 1700s and continued to hunt them until 1911. The first people to bring otter furs to the marketplace were the Russians. They made so much money selling them that other nations began hunting them too. Close to 1 million sea otters died during this period. The only reason the hunting stopped was that there were no more otters that could be found. Although it seemed too late, a law that was passed in 1911 made it illegal to hunt sea otters. This helped protect the few that remained. Now there are new dangers to sea otters. The main threat is oil spills. When oil sticks to otters' fur, they can't float or stay warm. Alaskan sea otters have already been injured by oil spills, and California sea otters are also at risk. You can see all of the places that they once lived in this map. The yellow is where they used to live, and the red is where they live now. Because sea otters sleep, raft, and feed in the kelp bed, often swimming below surface, they can also be injured by careless boaters. Even though they have no propellers, jet skis can zip through the kelp and run over otters and sometimes injure them seriously. Also, fishermen sometimes drop walls of netting to catch fish. They're called gill nets because fish swim into the mesh and are trapped when their gills get caught. But sometimes sea otters and other marine mammals get tangled in the nets too. Now, under California law, fishermen cannot put their gill nets in water less than 180 feet deep. Sea otters seldom dive that deep, so the law gives them better protection. Here is an oiled sea otter that they're going to clean and try to help. The return of the sea otter is a success story for wildlife conservation. More than 200 years ago, seal and whale hunters, explorers, and traders thought that there was an unlimited supply of sea otters. The fur was thought to be the most beautiful in the world and was worn by Asian royalty and was prized in Europe. Some sea otters were slaughtered by the thousands. One Alaskan village exported 15,000 otter skins in a single year. At the beginning, curious sea otters made it easy for fur hunters. They swam up to boats. When they became more wary, the female otters continued to swim to the boats if their infants had been taken. Young sea otters also approached the boats if their mother had been killed and taken aboard. The rapid decline of sea otters promoted their early protection, but when Alaska was purchased by the United States in 1867, the raid on sea otters began again. By 1900, the take had dropped from almost 50,000 to 127. The sea otter that had ranged from Japanese and Russian waters to Baja California seemed doomed to extinction. In 1911, the sea otter won belted protection from a treaty from the United States, Great Britain, which included Canada, Russia, and Japan. In the late 1930s, a small sea otter colonies were discovered off Amichik Island in Monterey, California. In 1966, it was estimated that there were 40,000 sea otters in existence. And today the estimates are above 170,000. The sea otters made a comeback after they were rescued from extinction early this century. Because they are protected, their ranks continue to grow. If protection continues, the sea otters may one day repopulate to their former range, extending all the way to Baja California. Like other animals, sea otters have their role to play in maintaining balance in the natural world. The kelp that harbors other sea creatures is protected by sea otters, which subsist largely on sea urchins, the destroyers of kelp. Animals native to environments are beneficial to their habitat. Sea otters help maintain a natural balance along the Pacific coast. And here you can see another part of a nonfiction book, which is the index. So if you were trying to research something, you could look back here and find what page it might be on. It's a good book about sea otters. So now you know all about sea otters. It's time to find out about one specific sea otter, a baby sea otter called Rialto. This book is Rescuing Rialto, a Baby Sea Otter's Story. Words by Linda V. Mapes and photographs by Alan Bernier. This book is published by Roaring Book Press. Baby Sea Otter Story. Rialto Beach at Olympic National Park is so wild that it is a wonder that the baby sea otter was found at all. Visitors to the beach that sunny morning, the first day in August, saw the baby sea otter was in distress. They alerted a park ranger. When he arrived, Joe Alcorn saw what looked like a crumpled, sandy old towel, except it was moving and shrieking. The baby otter was barely strong enough to right himself. He didn't have much time left. Joe called the Washington Sea Otter Stranding Network. One of the network volunteers, Diana Lamborn, set out for the beach right away. When she arrived, she heard the baby otter shrieking from far away. Ee, ee! Baby otters have very loud voices, so their mothers can hear them over the wind and waves. Then Diana saw him. What should she do? If she picked him up, the pup would become used to humans and would never be able to go back to the wild. But if she left him, he would surely die. By that time, it was early evening, and the pup had been alone all day, maybe even longer. Diana called the people that she worked with at the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. Sea otters are protected by law, and Diana needed help deciding what to do. After speaking with them, she leaned over and picked up the pup. She settled him in a plastic tote in her car and started driving. The next challenge was finding a veterinarian or aquarium to help. Each time Diana made a phone call, the pup would scream. He shrieked and shrieked, and finally the Seattle Aquarium said it would help. Diana hurried to Seattle. This is a sea otter and its baby pup. What is the thickest, softest thing you can imagine? Now think of something thicker, softer, and fuzzier. Add big brown eyes, a warm, wriggly body under all that fur, velvety soft paws. Now imagine all sorts of sounds, soft coos, small squeaks, tiny groans. That's Rialto, a baby northern sea otter named for the beach where he was found. Baby sea otters are helpless. They can float. They're born with their eyes open, but they can't swim, groom, or feed themselves, so a baby sea otter never leaves its mother. A baby sleeps on her chest and nurses on her tummy between her paws as she floats on her back in the ocean. She will loop kelp around the pup to secure him when she dives down in the water to get food. That's to keep her pup from drifting away while she's gone. There are lots of animals that would love to eat a baby otter, such as eagles. In Alaska, brown bears, orcas, and wolves prey on them. Baby sea otters, including those in their mother's care, have only a 50% chance of surviving in the wild. A pup that washed up on the beach like Rialto would not live long without its mother to feed him, fluff his coat, and keep him clean, warm, and safe. Even after he was rescued, it was not certain that Rialto would survive. It was almost midnight by the time Diana and Rialto arrived at the Seattle Aquarium. Sea otter specialist Sean Larson was waiting for them, and she knew just what to do. She had raised baby sea otters at the aquarium before. Sean knew that Rialto was hungry. Like a human baby, he needs lots of nutrients. So she made him a formula using puppy milk replacement powder, warm water, and clams, mixing it up in a blender and putting it in a baby's bottle. "Are you ready, Muffin?" she asked, and then she gave Rialto his first bottle. She got towels, lots of warm towels, to get Rialto fluffed up, clean, warm, and dry. The staff at the Seattle Aquarium stayed with the baby otter every minute. He was never alone. Someone stayed with him all night, and someone was there the next morning when he woke up. Even on the weekends, when most people went home, Rialto's caregivers stayed with him. It took a rotating staff of about 20 people to just do what Rialto's mother would have done in the wild. Like most babies, Rialto slept a lot, as much as 16 hours out of 24. When he was rescued, he was just 1 to 2 weeks old and a little over a foot long, while adult otters can be 5 times that long. He still had so much growing up to do, and he needed to get healthy. He had a little muscle and no fat. He was just skin and bones. He had an upset stomach, and he had pneumonia, an infection in his lungs. Rialto was given his own crib with a water-filled mattress to help him feel at home like he was floating on sea. And he always had some ice cubes piled up in a bag for a pillow. He also liked the cold. Perhaps that was what it had felt like to rest against his mother's chest in the Pacific Ocean. You can see different pictures of Rialto. Unlike seals and whales, sea otters don't have blubber, a thick layer of fat under the skin that keeps animals warm in the cold ocean water. Instead, sea otters have the thickest fur coat of any animal on Earth, more than 500,000 hairs per square inch. That's so thick that, unlike human hair, you can't see the skin underneath when you part it. Sea otter fur has two layers, a covering of long hair, called guard hairs, and a very soft, dense layer underneath. Each hair has scales that interlock with one another, creating a jacket that traps air bubbles close to the otter's skin for insulation. Oil glands in their skin make the fur even more water-repellent. A healthy sea otter is warm and waterproof. Baby sea otters, like Rialto, have even fluffier coats than adults. It helps them float instead of sink, just like a life jacket that you wear when you're on a boat. A baby sea otter's fur is a soft golden color. When the otter gets older, it grows into the deep, rich brown fur of adults. At first, Rialto stayed in a tiny room in the aquarium, so Sean and his other caregivers could keep a close eye on him. But within weeks, Rialto was getting better. He started gaining weight, and x-rays showed his lungs were clear. He was over pneumonia. One of Rialto's caregivers drew this picture. Just a month after he was rescued, Rialto was swimming laps, sticking his head underwater, and blowing bubbles. Whenever Rialto was ready to get out of the pool, he would put his paws up on the edge and shake his head just like a dog, sending silvery drops of water flying in all directions. Sean laughed at that. She would reach in and pick up Rialto up and put him on her lap to dry him off with soft, clean towels. The staff at the aquarium did lots of laundry for Rialto. At around the same time that Rialto took his first swim, Sean gave him his first taste of solid food, fresh raw clam. Now that was delicious. Rialto nibbled the clam right from her fingers, and then he wanted more and more. Once Rialto started getting solid food, he couldn't get enough. Sometimes Sean would feed him as he swam in his pool, leaving a bite-sized piece of clam at the edge for him to snack on. He began to learn to feed himself using his paw. Sean fed him more and more things, raw clams, shrimps, and squids. His teeth were starting to come in, too. An adult sea otter's front teeth are sharp and strong enough to bite right through the hard shell on a crab's claws. Otters have flat molars in the back of their mouth, just like humans do, for crushing food. You can see his teeth right there. Rialto always had fresh piles of ice cubes in a plastic bag for a pillow. His caregivers at the aquarium made him toys out of ice that had been frozen into fun shapes. Rialto often held onto his ice toy as he napped, gripping it with his front paws to avoid dropping it when he turned over. He used his claws, which are retractable like a cat's, to really grip things like when he wanted to. Rialto also had a ball to play with and long pieces of felt, like the kelp his mother had wrapped around him when he lived in the sea. Rialto was getting bigger and stronger. He was becoming more and more lively and curious, investigating everything in his pool, diving and twirling and chasing his tail for fun. He was learning how to groom himself using his tongue and front paws, too. He learned how to put his head underwater and blow air into his fur to keep it fluffed up. In the wild, sea otters spend hours each day taking care of their coats to keep themselves warm and dry, even in extremely cold water. Rialto had changed from a struggling orphan into the otter who would not be ignored. If Rialto wanted to get back into his pool for a swim, he shrieked. If he wanted another ice toy, he shrieked. Or more clams, he shrieked and shrieked. The aquarium staff gave him what he wanted right away, and even once he was healthy and strong, they never left him alone. Sea otters are very social. They mostly live together in large groups called rafts. They even link their forepaws to stay together when they sleep, rest, or feed, the way that people hold hands. That keeps them from getting separated in big waves. They stay close together, winding themselves in kelp so they don't drift off into the open sea, and they rarely range far away from their home territory. Sea otter neighborhoods stick together for decades if there is enough food. The females and young ones stay in one raft, and the adult males in another. Sea otters live out their lives less than a mile and a half from the shore. Near the shore is where they can harvest a wide variety of food. Scallops, mussels, snails, squids, crabs, clams, shrimp, and even octopuses, to name a few. And it's where they can find one of their very favorite things of all, sea urchins. Here's a baby in kelp again. Sea otters have to eat and eat to keep their body temperatures up in the cold ocean water. They spend about a quarter to a third of their day hunting for food. And they need to eat about a quarter of their body weight every single day just to stay warm and active. To get their meals, sea otters dive and gather food from the seafloor using the sensitive pads of their front paws to feel for things that they can't see. They tuck what they gather into a pocket-like skin flap under their front legs. Sometimes an otter will also pick up a rock before it swims back to the surface. Then when it's floating on its back, it lays the rock on its chest and swiftly hits clams and other shellfish on the rock over and over to crack them open. Sea otters are one of the few species in the world that uses tools to eat. Rialto is growing fast, and his fur was slowly changing to the smoother dark brown of an adult. But he still had a long way to go before he would reach his adult size of 70 to 90 pounds. It was a lot bigger than he was then, but sea otters are the smallest marine mammal. They are much smaller than seals, dolphins, sea lions, and orcas. Sea otters are closer in size to their nearest animal relations, which include river otters, beavers, skunks, weasels, badgers, wolverines, and minks. In August and September, Rialto had lots of visits from staff at the aquarium in Vancouver, Canada, the nearest big city to Seattle. They were hoping to take care of Rialto and were also thinking about adopting him for their exhibit. The Vancouver Aquarium had a bigger pool with more room for a growing youngster. There, Rialto would be the only sea otter from Washington State for people in Vancouver to see. Once there were sea otters from all along the Pacific coast of Russia, Japan, North America, from Alaska all the way to Washington, Oregon, California, and Baja, Mexico. Sea otters have been in those waters for about 3 million years. Native people in all those places had coexisted with sea otters. Middens, the garbage dumps of people who lived long ago, found buried where they lived, included the bones of the animals that people hunted. At what once was a native village in Washington, archaeologists found a bone from a sea otter's back that had a harpoon point thrust through it. This tells us that native people from thousands of years ago hunted sea otters for food. We also know that they made robes from sea otters' warm, thick fur and used their teeth to decorate ceremonial canoes, paddles, wind chests, and other fine possessions. Then came more hunters who wanted the sea otters for their beautiful coats. First Russians came from the west, and then traders and explorers in North America arrived from the east. From 1741 until 1911, they killed sea otters in huge numbers for their coats, which they called pelts. Great piles of pelts were sent all the way to China on ships. The sea otter furs were sold there for a very high price. Finally, in 1911, after the last sea otter in Washington was shot, a law was passed to protect them. And from 1911 to 1969, it was almost too late, and there were no sea otters along the coast of Washington. But then suddenly there was no kelp either. With no sea otters to eat the sea urchins, there were too many urchins, and they ate all the kelp. Soon there were just bare rocks and sand. Without the great underwater forest of green kelp, tiny fish and other sea animals that had lived there no longer had homes. The whole nearshore environment had changed because sea otters were gone. That's why sea otters are called a keystone species. Like the keystone at the top of an arch, they hold everything in their ecosystem together. A keystone species makes a place complete in terms of which plants and animals live there, and even what foods are available and how a place functions. In 1969 and 70, the scientists decided to see if they could bring sea otters back. Though there were no more sea otters in Washington, some had survived in parts of Alaska. They hoped that these sea otters would make a new home in Washington. Not all of the sea otters that moved survived, but some did and they had families. Today, all the sea otters in Washington are related to those relocated from Alaska, even Rialto. More sea otters were moved to other sites in Alaska and British Columbia. They found all the sea urchins had been multiplying when there were no sea otters around, and then the sea otters ate urchin after urchin. After the sea otters returned, the kelp grew back, once again swaying lush and green, providing homes for small darting fish, such as juvenile salmon and rockfish, for crab larvae, and for other tiny creatures. Today, sea otters dive through the beautiful kelp forests and drift in rafts alongside them. After being hunted to near extinction, there are now more than 100,000 wild sea otters living along the western coast of North America. Yet it is still a rare treat for people to see a wild sea otter. Many have only seen them at aquariums. At the Vancouver Aquarium, they really wanted to have another baby sea otters for visitors to enjoy and learn from. Just 6 weeks after Rialto first arrived in Seattle, Sean got him up early and let him swim and swim and swim. She hoped that it would let him get tired out. It was moving day. She fed him lots and lots of clams and lots of shrimp. Then she got him dried off and comfortable, and she held him tight, and Rialto put one paw on her face. Sea otters have sensitive pads on their paws like cats do, and they use them to feel things, whether it's a clam on the bottom of the sea or, for Rialto, Sean's face. It was as if he was saying, "It's okay, you can come visit." Soon it was time for Rialto to go. People arrived with a big carrier on wheels, and in he went. Sean hurried alongside so he wouldn't be frightened. As the driver got behind the wheel, Sean sat down in the back of the van, right next to Rialto in his carrier, holding his paw to keep him company. They were headed to Vancouver. Christy Heffron, Rialto's head caregiver in Vancouver, had driven down to pick up Rialto and to help keep him company, too. At the Canadian border, the guards asked if she or Sean had anything to declare. "Just a sea otter," said Christy. "Eee," said Rialto. His voice was so loud that people in cars nearby could hear him, even though the van's doors and windows were closed. At the Vancouver Aquarium, the staff were waiting for him in the driveway, but they heard him before they saw him, of course. "Eee, eee!" They wheeled Rialto on a cart to his new nursery and opened his cage. Rialto went straight for his pool and in for a swim. It seemed like anywhere there was water, Rialto felt at home. Rialto's new caregiver gave him ice toys, and Sean had brought his favorite foods and his bottle. There was a crib for him with one of the high sides so he wouldn't tumble out, along with fresh white towels to keep him dry, clean, and fluffy. In Vancouver, there were many, many people to take care of him, just like there had been in Seattle. So even though Sean didn't want to leave Rialto, she knew it was time for her to go. She left, promising to come back soon. In late October, a little more than a month after Rialto moved to Canada, Sean came to visit him. She wondered, "Will Rialto know who I am?" "Hi, Muffin," she said when she came to his crib. "Eee," Rialto said. He knew who she was, all right. Sean let Rialto smell her hand and gave him a big bucket of ice to play with. What fun he had, making the cubes fly. It was hard for Sean to say goodbye when it was time to go. On November 1st, Rialto had a new visitor. It was a woman with a carrier like Rialto had arrived in, and she brought it over to the big pool next to Rialto's nursery. The visitor and Christy opened the carrier door, and what should come out but two baby sea otters? They had been rescued, like Rialto, named Mac and Kunik. These babies were from Alaska. They were just a little older than Rialto. At first, Rialto stuck close to Christy's feet as he watched Mac and Kunik tumble and play. Pretty soon they came right up to Rialto and gave him a good looking over. After that, it wasn't too long before Rialto hopped in the water too. Now, day after day, the three baby sea otters play and play. Silvery air bubbles trail up from their coats as they dive in their 10,000-gallon tank of seawater. The baby's caregivers bring them fresh clams and fish to eat. At feeding time, the pups sit in their particular order they've been taught to, first, second, and third. They sleep in one big pile of wriggling brown atop a mound of ice cubes, and they dip and swirl and swim for hours and hours. Independent now, Rialto knows just from a hand signal to haul himself out of the pool to get fed. He's not in the wild, but for people visiting from all the world, Rialto is an ambassador for Washington's wild sea otters. Sometimes he seems to know it, sitting up extra tall, showing off just a little. Sean noticed that he always pays special attention to the children who visit him at the Vancouver Aquarium, swimming right over to see them through the glass sides of his pool. "He's just so sunny and brimming with joy in life," she says, "and being an otter." At the back of this book, it tells you what you might need to do if you find a stranded sea otter or other marine animal. It says, don't touch it or pick it up. It's illegal to do so under the Marine Mammal Protection Act. Wild animal rescue requires special care that is given by trained experts and must be authorized by government agency. Contact the Wildlife Agency or Marine Mammal Stranding Network in your community for help. And you might want to watch over the animal to make sure that onlookers and dogs don't touch it. But don't get too close. You could scare the animal away. Stay quiet and don't try to bother or assist the animal in any way. Call for help, and the people who know how to do it safely for the animal and for you will help. There's also a list of sources, because this is a nonfiction book. It's real, true life. And so any real, true life thing is going to have sources that they cite where they got all the information from. So that was all about sea otters. They're such a cute animal, and it's really cool to hear how the scientists and other environmental enthusiasts were able to get the sea otters to come back into areas where they had been hunted. Makes you think about the types of things that you could do if to help the environment in your area. Once again, my name is Sarah Mari. I'm one of the librarians at Portland Public Library in Portland, Maine. Thank you for listening and learning all about sea otters, and I hope to see you again soon. Bye!